Welcome back to KTN Friday Briefing. Thank you very much for staying with us. As you can see, we're now on the hot seat, as I'd like to call it, with our guest anchor, Kalembe Ndiles. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
I want to know, where have you been? It's until recently that we started seeing your pictures on newspapers, on the internet, but where have you been?
You see, after general elections, after the petition, I went back to my normal business.
What's normal?
You know, I'm a contractor, and also I am a farmer.
A farmer. What do you farm? Sorry if I seem like I'm meddling, but I'm interested.
Mango, I grow mango.
Okay. Yeah. And especially in Ukambani.
In Ukambani as well, yeah.
That's nice. Mm. But then the thing is, for a long time, we used to hear Kalembe Ndile. Kalembe and squatters was like one and the same thing. Mm. What happened? We no longer see in the news, you know, fighting for these people. Were they finally resettled? Because you were known as Mwanawa squatter.
Yeah, I tried to settle 1,000 families, and the remaining 2,000 families are still at the squatter camps. Mm-hmm. And you know, when you are not in the parliament, you can do a little. Because now the question is, if I start visiting like the offices, people will ask,
what are you doing here?
What are you doing here? And you know, you have been out of parliament. Yes.
So, I mean, how has it been for you being out of parliament? Do you watch sometimes parliament and the proceedings, and you feel like, no, if I was there, I would have done this differently?
Yeah, I could have done better.
What exactly?
Because at the moment, what parliament is doing is a big shame.
What exactly?
You know, the scandals, and you know, at this time of insecurity, they should have dealt with the laws which can bring to an end insecurity by asking. For the example, I saw somebody who was taken to court, and he was freed on bond, and he was charged having a grenade, and to me, that person, where he got that grenade, will go back and
Get some more.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so you're saying if you're in parliament, you'd have done more in terms of security. What else? Because there's a time I saw you saying that if you're in parliament, the time that we had women being stripped, you would have done something about it. I saw it on your Twitter page.
Yeah, you come up with good laws which protects women also. And many more. You see, if you see what is happening in parliament, even it was a shame the way the security bill, the way they interacted with the because the chaos and the fight, you know, they were like former councillors, and even the councillors are better than them.
One and the same thing as MCAs, what we see these days with the MCAs.
No, MCAs are better off than parliament.
Because
you saw what happened, and how they were shedding the speaker. You see, sometimes when the MCAs, but let me call them former councillors, what they used to do was they fought among themselves, but they never touched the speaker. But now it was like there was no order. It was like a shame.
All right. So we'll come back to this particular conversation, but I want us to shed light on another top story that we have been following for you with John Alanamu. And of course, we'll come back to Kalembe Ndile in a short while. But Nyali Member of Parliament Hezron Awiti Bolo spent a lot of time this past Wednesday defending himself against claims of his involvement with metal refinery EPZ, the lead smelting factory. The waste from his factory has killed dozens and poisoned hundreds in the village of Owino Uhuru, situated next to it. Bolo even claimed that some of the sick children featured in the Inside Stories Plague for Profit were not from the area. However, documentary evidence has now emerged, proving a direct link between the embattled MP and the killer factory. KTN's John Alanamu has the new details that include the name of yet another member of parliament.
Three busloads of supporters, a two-hour press conference, come political rally, and one message.
If you build houses or premises, are there many? Surely. Can you know the person rent your house to know to know what he's doing inside there. Can you know? You can't know.
Nyali Member of Parliament Hezron Awiti Bolo's attempt to distance himself from proof that he was a partner of the owners of metal refinery EPZ, a lead smelting plant whose waste has caused untold suffering to thousands of residents of Owino Uhuru village in Mombasa.
Like now here, I'm a member of parliament. Wale mnauza hapa, wanaweza kuuza hata changa. Mimi nitajuaje wanauza changa?
But can he distance himself from this? In an attempt to clear itself over apparent complicity in the pollution of the environment at Owino Uhuru, officers within the Public Health Office availed these documents to KTN. They indicate that not only was Awiti Bolo the owner of the land upon which the smelting plant sat, he was, at one point, its executive chairman. The role of an executive chairman in most companies is reserved for an individual who plays an oversight role in the company, but also makes decisions about the day-to-day operations of that company. An executive chairman would also be a key signatory to any financial transaction made by that company and can draw a salary from the company. In essence, Hezron Awiti Bolo is not only the co-owner of the property on which metal refinery EPZ was built, benefiting from rent collected, but he was also deeply involved in the day-to-day running of the same company. Therefore, Awiti Bolo as executive chairman cannot claim this.
Surely, can you know the person rent your house to know what he's doing inside there? Can you know? You can't know.
The documents, with dates ranging from 2010 to 2011, are correspondence between the then Ministry of Public Health and Hezron Awiti Bolo over a 2009 closure of the metal refinery, pending its fulfillment of various safeguards within the factory, the most important of which being that the factory did not have a proper waste disposal system. The documents available to KTN have Awiti Bolo's first correspondence with the Provincial Director of Public Health, Dr. Anissa Omar, saying that the factory had complied with all the demands made by the ministry and that John Dungo, the then Kilindini Public Health Officer, had inspected the factory. The correspondence continues into 2010, with Bolo again writing on behalf of Metal Refinery EPZ, referring to the factory's plans to dispose of the toxic waste created by the metal refinery and approvals from Public Health and NEMA to reopen the factory. On the 17th of June 2011, the narrative changes. This letter, also signed by Awiti Bolo as the metal refinery's executive chairman, is the company's response to yet another closure order issued this time by Public Health, not because of the internal functions of the factory, but over claims of dumping of waste at a seasonal river in Jomvu. This is the water pan in question. One that, at the time of our investigation, was found to have been a dumping site of another refinery. But according to the Ministry of Public Health, Metal Refinery EPZ, under the executive chairmanship of Hezron Awiti Bolo, also dumped lead waste here. Tests conducted by Quality Control Company, SGS, for KTN's Inside Story and Jicho Pevu found that the area...
Right, we'll get back to that particular report by John Allen Nam, of course, giving us the developments following that inside story piece, Plague for Profit, in a short while. But for now, let's get back to our guest anchor. And of course, so many questions coming in from you, and I'll be taking a look at them in just a short while. But I want us to talk about this new appointment. First of all, congratulations.
Thank you.
So have you, you've obviously accepted it, right? Because yes. You know, you can tell President Rukicha, no thank you.
You know, there is a Swahili saying which says that mchagua jembe si mkulima.
Mchagua jembe.
So I have accepted.
You've
accepted.
Yes. All right. But the thing is, this appointment comes with a lot of controversy because people are saying that he chose to recycle politicians. What's your comment on that?
I don't think so, because, you know, to serve in a board, doesn't mean that it's a full-time work. Mm-hmm. So it's like you are coming together to, you are not the implementers. Mm-hmm. You are like the watchdog. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's, any youth person who has come out of university is supposed to just meet once a week and just go home.
But
so
you know,
to me, I think somebody who has that energy should be doing that. Like in an organization, we have like three levels, mm-hmm. like the workers and the managers and the top managers. Mm-hmm. So in a board, you are supposed to be the overseer. So I don't think.
But don't you think, I mean, young people, we have very many brilliant minds in Kenya who would do maybe better than what you will be able to do, considering that you've been around for a long time, giving young people this opportunity. Opportunities, because we have young people, close to 70% of young people in Kenya are unemployed.
Okay, I went through the list, but these young people who have been given a job, like the sports chairman is Muteti, is I think is 32. Mm-hmm. So it was a mixture. And you know, I think also you don't ignore experience, mm-hmm. so that you don't make an informed decisions. Yeah.
But how then are the young people supposed to get this, you know, this jobs that President Uhuru Kenyatta once promised them, if you know the lion's share is given to people who've been there for such a long
but
time?
But to serve in a board is not like a job. Mm-hmm. It's like you are volunteering yourself, mm-hmm. because you don't even earn salary. You earn an allowance. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's a full job. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you think the youth in Kenya are properly represented in this particular government?
Yeah, I think so.
Why?
Because I have talked about Muteti was given sports, which is a youth driven. Mm-hmm. And also there's this guy who was a musician.
You're talking about Jaguar?
Jaguar, he was given
but
a
that's,
job.
That's just, you know, a very small number compared to what we've seen in the other appointments.
I don't think so, but I think the president balanced. But if you talk about the whole, old people, mm-hmm. you know, I'm 50, mm-hmm. 51 now, mm-hmm. and those who are complaining, like Raila Odinga is over 70, mm-hmm. so I think they should ask themselves whether they are the ones who should quit, mm-hmm. because me, I think we have energy, we are ready to serve the country.
And what will you bring to the table in this particular board?
Depending on what I'm supposed to do, but I will be just wanting to ask to know simple questions, mm-hmm. like why is it that 1 liter of water is expensive than petrol, mm-hmm. which comes from abroad, then the process of refinery, transport, and then it is like if you want to buy a bottle of water, 1 liter is more than 100, mm-hmm. and now petrol is less. Mm-hmm. Why is it that water is more costly than mm-hmm. petrol? So mm-hmm. those answers will be... You see, I will be seeking to know why, what happened, mm-hmm. yes.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, so the thing is, watch this space for us to see what you'll be able to achieve.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's talk a bit of politics. What happened to Tip-Tip? Tip-Tip Amani
Tip-Tip
Kenya.
Is still intact.
Is it?
We have one elected member of parliament. Uh-huh. In fact, the member for the place of Mudama is a Tip member. We have more than 27 MCS, mm-hmm. yeah.
Okay.
Even in Migori, we have MCS. Mm-hmm. In Machakos, in Makueni, we have like 5. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right.
So the party is still intact.
Someone here asked a very interesting question. Felix Okemo on Twitter says, Kaleme, now that you have been given this particular government position, will you support Jubilee in 2017 as Tip-Tip?
I think that is what we are gearing, mm-hmm. because At the end of the day, we should ask ourselves whether it was smooth in court. Mm-hmm. And the answer, it wasn't smooth. Mm-hmm. Because some funny decisions were made without consultation, mm-hmm. including when people say that we are together, mm-hmm. we as parties, as partners,
yes,
and someone goes to appeal to the electorate, mm-hmm. to elect you know, the three piece. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? Mm-hmm. So it wasn't comfortable in court because sometimes we disagreed. Mm-hmm. But the decision was coming from just one place. Mm-hmm. And if you have seen recently, what Wetangula was complaining the other day, mm-hmm. that things are being done in Bakado. So to me, I think it will be something else. And also, we should ask ourselves one question. Mm-hmm. You know, Uhuru was just, according to the rank, he was just lesser mm-hmm. rank, mm-hmm. comparing with the Prime Minister, Raila Odinga, and Kalonzo was Vice President. And the question is, Ruto was just a small person, but they came to power. Mm-hmm. What went wrong? That is the question. Or the ODM and court should ask themselves.
They should ask them
because they, you know, according to them, we are telling them, you know, this is not the way you think. But they it's like they won. They have already won.
So you're saying, come 2017, you will support President Uhuru Kenyatta.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Will you run for political office once again?
Of course, why not? Because at the moment, those who are serving in parliament, especially in Kibwezi, people are complaining mm-hmm. because they are underperforming. Because I have already set the bar.
You remember? Did you set the bar? What
yeah,
did you
I was
do?
The first MP mm-hmm. even in Kenya to buy a grader mm-hmm. to do roads. Mm-hmm. And you remember roads were bad saved because of the El Nino. Mm-hmm. And also I was the first MP to buy a backhoe loader, mm-hmm. which does lead to about water. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. So those are your achievements.
A lot of achievement. And you know. Remember CDF, we got 6 million, mm-hmm. and the second batch was 28 million mm-hmm. and 48 million, mm-hmm. and now the parliament was dissolved.
Okay.
So you can now imagine somebody who is handling 100 million, and he does nothing. Even the tractors we are grounded.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we have a lot to talk about, but let me just bring in some of the questions that are coming in. Someone says that is JT. TI says, ask him what new ideas he has to push the government agenda forward, and what new thing he has brought to the table.
You see, in terms of my background, you know, we went without water, we went without food. So sometimes those experience we have, and we know how we can do better mm-hmm. than what we used to do. Because sometimes when I was a counselor, mm-hmm. We usually interacted with those workers, water workers, and we know what we can do.
Mm-hmm. You brought in a very interesting point about, you know, you were brought up sometimes without food and water. Let's talk about your childhood. Was it grace to grass or grass to grace? Many people don't know a lot about where you started.
You see, okay,
from.
I was born in Uganda.
Mm-hmm.
In Uganda. And even the name Kalembe was a nickname.
Ah, okay.
It was because my mother used to take me to Kilembe Hospital, and because I was very small, they called me Kalembe instead of Kilembe because I was
so Kilembe then, Hospital.
Yes, Kilembe Hospital. Okay, uh-huh. Then after Nyerere Amin War mm-hmm. is when our parents decided that we have to go back to Kenya. Mm-hmm. And you remember my father was a plant operator. They did the Marara Tungam Road. Mm-hmm. So we came to Kenya, and that is how we found ourselves as squatters. Because now, even to date, I can say, okay, Kalembe has land, but my father is landless. Mm-hmm. That is why I call myself son of a squatter. Because the squatter is my father, okay. But me, I have land.
Let's talk about the struggles you had. You didn't have land. You know, talking about going to school. How was that?
Yeah, it was difficult mm-hmm. because even when I did my Form 4, I had a balance. Mm-hmm. Then I had to go to work in a transport company in Mombasa. Mm-hmm. By two brothers as an office messenger. Mm-hmm. I was also a loader. Then after getting some little money to clear mm-hmm. so that I can get the certificate, mm-hmm. I found the school was owned by an Asian, and he has already left, and there was nobody to respond to my paper. So mm-hmm. when I wanted to vie for parliamentary, mm-hmm. the requirement was that you have to be a Form 4 leaver.
Yes, yes.
Then I did my O level in Aria High School, mm-hmm. that is London GCE mm-hmm. International Exam. Mm-hmm. That is
All right. So
and you know, I used to cut charcoal after we, the closure of school, chul hues to pay for my school fees.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right. So many young people right now can relate to what you're talking about. And just before you get to introduce the story to us, maybe a word of encouragement for young to young people who are really struggling with the same
thing. I would urge the young people who are educated, they should not like look for a certain job. You know, when I was an office messenger, and the boss, I could hear the boss demanding a secretary. I could even interact with him and say, I have a good person. So that, and if I had papers, I could have taken the job. But the problem is that I didn't have good papers. But to me, if you work, you work hard and you have good papers, in that company you can as well get good job.
Okay.
So to me, they should not like, you have a degree and you can't do this. Me, I have done a lot of job, which I think is not my profession, but I try.
You tried.
Like today, I'm here.
Yeah, like you're here, you're just about to read news. Who knows, maybe we could, Joe Agueo, my managing editor, can employ you. Come on, let's go and see if you can read the news. Let's see if we can get you another job. Apart from just, you know, what you've been able to do. All right, there you go. Have a seat.
Thank you.
So you'll have to introduce yourself to the audience. You know, like how you did it. You know, like how we did it when we started the news.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that they get to know exactly who you are once again. The news, the guest anchor of the day. But there, this is a backup of the script that you'll be reading. But we don't want you to read from there. We want you to read from that particular camera, camera two. So if you can, introduce yourself and take it away. He's going to go slowly.
Thank you. Welcome, viewers. I'm Kalem Bendile, son of a squatter. As we celebrate the Labor Day, many of you will remember the common saying that any kind of work is work. But would you let your son, husband, work full-time in a graveyard? KTN's Kamiche Menza now brings us the story. Those men who have thrown their fear out of the window and decided to earn a living by working around those who have left.
Just like any other working person, Martin Okech gets ready for the day ahead, all in a bid to make hay as the sun shines. A few minutes later, he departs for his place of work. This is where he spends most of his daytime, at the cemetery where the dead rest. But first things first, putting his equipment in place, then he puts on his work garments. His work here is to dig graves and sometimes cementing covered graves. But how did he find himself in this kind of job? His dreams of being a lawyer, he says, died after quitting school due to lack of school fees.
Brother Fadangu alikuwa mortuary and cemetery superintendent. Yeye alikuwa anasimamia huku. Babangu mdogo. Sasa wakati bado mimi nilikuwa wakati shule imefungwa, nilikuwa nikikuja kuomba kibarua na niambia kama kuna kufieka. Hivyo ninakuja ninafieka kama pale kwa mochari kuna kupalilia maua, naenda hapo kwa mochari napalilia maua. Sasa hapo ndio nilianza. Sasa vile nilizidi nikazoea ndio sasa mpaka nikaona tu nimeizoea kabisa.
In a day he digs two graves, each taking him between 2 to 3 hours. Then embarks on simple available tasks here. He says it's not always that one wakes up to a scheduled task. Sometimes they spend a day with none, but he has never given up. The number of graves he has dug, uncountable, enabling him ache out a living from the dead.
Lakini mimi naambia kuna kazi mbaya, pesa ni pesa.
Mimi unajua mimi naogopa kazi kama hiyo, naogopa. Lakini kulingana tu vile mapato yake iko sometimes, naona ni kama tu inatusaidia sana kwa hii nyumba.
He's not alone though. Some like him are just casual laborers, while others have been employed. There's a myriad of tasks here, including engraving and grooming the graves. The first grave on this graveyard, tracing back to 1901.
Mwanzoni kwa familia, hawakuichukulia ikiwa jambo nzuri. Lakini baada ya kuona huo mtu anajikimu kimaisha, wakaichukulia ni jambo la kawaida.
Bwana anaandika hizi Bible mbili kwa siku. Na hii kuandika hii Bible nalipa pesa ngapi?
Hii nalipisha 4,000 to 5,000.
Mm-hmm.
Inalingana na urefu.
Mimi naweza taka omba, naweza omba kazi permanent kutoka kwa county. Kwa sababu tuna tena tuko na experience, tumeizoea, tunaijua.
So unakuta ni kazi inahofiwa. Wale wachache ambao tunapata ni wako kwa kiwango cha chini zaidi kukubaliana na kazi kama hii. Although kazi yenyewe ni kazi nzuri. Yaani kazi tu ya kawaida kama zile kazi zingine.
Most of us do not visit this place so often simply because of its status of isolation and loneliness. But for 15 years, this has been Okechi's place where he earns his daily bread. Kamche Menza, KTN, at the Nakuru North Cemetery, Nakuru County.
Thank you very much, Kamche Menza, for that interesting story. Like you said, kazi ni kazi.
Kazi ni kazi. Kazi,
hakuna kazi mzuri, mbaya.
Mbaya. Uh-huh. Unaweza njiani upate ingine mzuri. Unaweza. Kwa hivyo unaanza na ile ambao.
Ile uko nayo.
Uko nayo.
Ile uko nayo sahi.
Ndiyo.
So now, how was the experience? Kusoma news, how was it?
the screen was running fast.
Oh, it was fast. Yeah. Madeka, my auto key operator, why now? So it was running fast.
And I'm not used to that.
You're not used to it.
Yes.
But I think you did well. Mm. I'll give you
2%.
Let me give you 50%. 50 because I thought you were a bit slow, but with practice I think you can catch up. So maybe if you 2017 ikifika na maneno isende vizuri, I think you can come back and we can train you at a small cost.
Sure.
All right, so you can also tell us how you think he fared, and of course what we've been talking about, his childhood and how he's risen from bottom to top. You can of course tell us your sentiments on this particular interview, and of course on what he has been able to achieve and how he performed tonight. But for now, where do we go now?
we have to have a short commercial break.
Yes, we have to have it.
Watching KTN Friday Briefing.